passionate people here who feel very strongly about what's going on in our city with regards to real estate. And it's always on everybody's mind these days. A number of things have happened since the last time we met, and these things do impact the situation. Justin Trudeau and his Liberal government have now firmly taken hold. Banks have been speaking about measures that should be taken to cool the housing market. Just last week, Mayor Gregor Robertson said he was going to be looking at ways to implement taxes on vacant homes, and there was some more discussion about that today on the news. We've seen Britain vote to leave the EU, and just yesterday, the Liberal government announced an extra $150 million over the next 2 years to be put towards affordable housing in BC. So obviously we know the Vancouver housing market is a very complex issue with no easy solutions or answers. However, tonight we hope to shed some light on what we can do as individuals and as a community to address some of the concerns that many of us have. So our panel will begin by addressing a few of the questions you sent in through the website, and then from there we'll open the floor to questions. So the evening will start now and will end at 9:30, which gives us just under 2 hours. And to ensure the interest of the larger group is respected, we'd like to get as many of your questions in as possible. So we need to keep the discussion going where we can, so that's going to be my role, so forgive me if I cut you off. But we want to be fair to everybody and try to get a very wholesome dialogue. Each panel member will just make a slight introduction and speak about their thoughts and where things are at. And Tom Davidoff is going to start. He had the opportunity to meet with Justin Trudeau when he was in town recently, and we thought it would be interesting to hear what that meeting was like. So take it away.
Yeah, so first of all, obviously, you know, he came up to meet me, and he was so nervous I knocked over my name tag, but he made eye contact and somehow knew my name, so we're in good hands. He's a very skilled politician. I felt like he listened actively to everything in the room. And I guess I'll summarize. Yeah, please. Oh, no, I can just speak louder. That's fine.
Okay, right.
Okay, let me speak more about it. Yep. Okay, so Trudeau, I thought, was fantastic. An active listener, he knows what's going on. You know, if you talk about the levels of government, I think the political gamesmanship is pretty interesting. The city can manage land use in the different municipalities. So if you want to make housing cost less, which is maybe what we want done, but of course that's controversial because if you're a homeowner and housing costs less, that means you're poorer. So what we've got is cities control land use. So one way to drive down prices is to build more. But that's challenging in a city because building more means in Vancouver not filling in cornfields, but building up, and nobody wants an apartment next door. So homeowners get annoyed, obviously, if you ask them to densify. The province could force the city to build more. They don't really want to. They're scared of the same angry homeowners the city is. They have the ability to tax, probably more than anybody else. Asking people who don't live and work here, or at least don't work here, to pay more in taxes is something the province can do. But the province, I think, has three pressures on them that make them very reluctant to do anything like that. Pressure one is, like any politicians, they rely on the real estate industry for contributions, and, you know, who wants to annoy your contributors? Issue two, let's face it, people who vote in provincial elections aren't renters. A lot of them aren't even in Metro Vancouver, but as the price pressure spills out, you might think renters around the province would care, but you know, you've read 1984, if there's hope, it lies in the rolls. Well, if there's hope for political pressure to do something about housing demand with a tax, the hope lies in renters, who by and large aren't voters. So expecting action, at least from this current government, both because of two political pressures, I think, is unlikely. There's a third pressure on them. I forget what I was thinking about. The Feds, I don't know what to expect. You know, for the Feds, if somebody grows up in Vancouver, has a dream of opening a yoga studio, but it doesn't pay enough, and they have to move to Toronto and become a consultant or an investment banker, that's literally not a federal issue. That doesn't create unemployment. It doesn't lead the banks to collapse. It's sad for the yoga guy. Or, you know, I mean, this is a serious thing. Like my son's trombone teacher. What a nice, beautiful young woman who just wanted to be a professional musician. And, you know, forget it. She can't, you know, she lives with eight people in a basement, and she's going back to the prairie to be a music teacher. So it's sad. And there's a human cost. But it's not a federal issue. So, you know, we put forward this tax proposal to ask people who buy property here but don't pay income taxes to pick up more property tax. The city's gonna do something close with a vacancy tax. It's kinda close, because if you use the place, I think even as a pied-à-terre vacation type place, anything other than you're the landlord or a principal residence, they'll ask for a tax. I think the province won't even go for that because it gets a little bit close to clamping down on what I think is the most important source of real demand growth here, which is international demand. Let me say another quick word. I don't want to yak too much, although I guess that's the point. You know, the next meeting I was at was a follow-up meeting, and that was with Yves Duclos, an economist, which was great, so I got to do a whole supply-demand diagram with him. And the head of CMHC, you know, there's two worries, right? Worry one is, in the long run, look, in the short run, if you ask anybody from China, what they'll tell you is every single rich person in China wants to be here, right? I mean, and I think given our nationality, we ought to have a lot of sensitivity to that, you know, like people with money who are hated and, you know, the government's gonna be mean to them, can't breathe the air and all that jazz, so of course they wanna come here. But the government doesn't let it, you know. You have to smurf out 50,000 bucks at a time and get 10 people to put down the down payment. It's a real challenge. And so in the short run, you know, if you build more houses, there's not infinite demand, you can push down prices. But arguably in the long run, unless you do something and say, if you don't work here, you know, you gotta pay so much that it's unattractive, this is just gonna be a playground for the rich. And it's the Chinese today, but we have very low taxes if you're from overseas. Property taxes are low. It's going to be the Russians and the Middle Easterners in time, and probably the Nigerians. Anybody with a kleptocratic regime to deal with at home is coming. And so 20, 30 years from now, if you do nothing, I don't think there's any question that, you know, work for a living, secretary, teacher, doctor, lawyer, business school professor for sure. No way we can recruit at UBC. It's just going to get more and more expensive. So that's one risk. But you know, how in the short run, who knows what's going to happen in China. The domestic demand looks like a bubble. And here's the thing I really worry about from an American perspective. San Francisco had a price boom in the early 2000s. And that I would call a kosher price boom. Because San Francisco, you can't build anymore. It's got all the same stories we have here in actually in an economy, okay? But then it started spilling over into what's called the Central Valley of California, towns like Antioch, Redwood, Stockton, Fresno, Modesto, these like nowhere bumpkin towns. And you can build houses there. It's flat, you know, it's a pain, just like here with the ALR, there's government process, but you can build. And it's not A locations. And I'm hearing about Mission, Hope, and Chilliwack, which I only know from exit signs, so I can't say much about them. But I'm starting to see concerning signs that you're getting this sort of drive till you qualify, it was called, right? You can't get enough money for a down payment in town. You go to East Bam, that doesn't work. Next stop, Burnaby, New West, the Brooklyn of Vancouver. But eventually you get to the hinterland where you can actually build houses, I think. That worries me because shady, you know, not great mortgage terms and paying more than you should for a house that a builder can really replicate just for the cost of building it. So short run, I think there's a real possibility of a fairly nasty correction. And the reason I think it could be nasty, is prices today, you know, if you buy a share of RBC stock, RBC earns 8 cents for every dollar you invest. If you invest in Genworth, the mortgage insurance company, they earn 12 cents for every dollar you invest. If you buy a house here, a detached house, you get 1.5 cents for every dollar you invest. If you buy an apartment, you get 2.5 cents. So you're really banking on appreciation for these prices to make any sense as an investment. And if people stop believing appreciation because the appreciation stops, you know, I don't think the exit stock, the last floor on the elevator is a 20% decline. I think it could be ugly. So long run is terrible because everybody's priced out. Short run's probably going to be okay and prices will bob along, but there's a really nasty scenario with 20-30% probability too, and the Feds are worried about that.
Thank you, Tom. Okay, Michael.
So let me start by telling you, I don't actually believe everything I say. So you should take everything I say with a pinch of salt. Because we're often being asked to answer questions that we honestly don't know the answers to, but we feel that since we've been invited to sit up here instead of down there, there's an obligation for us to be sage. But I am going to at least share some of the thoughts that I have been reading, and hopefully what you'll get tonight is a mixture of a philosophical conversation about the housing situation in Vancouver and where it might be going, but also some very practical advice to suit your particular situation in terms of whether if you're about to rent a place or even, God forbid, try and buy a place, that we can share with you some solid advice, because it's a beautiful evening and you've come here, and I think we three of us welcome the opportunity to chat and hopefully answer some questions and share some information. I wasn't invited to join Mr. Trudeau, even though I once worked for his father, but because I write for the Courier once every 2 weeks, I was invited to come into the room while the Prime Minister made his opening statement. I took a picture of Tom with the Prime Minister.
Did you?
Which I posted in the newspaper.
Yeah, I haven't seen it.
No, I have a picture.
My hands were shaking too.
Well, there were other people there. But I did write a column in the Courier offering my advice to the Prime Minister, and maybe at some point tonight we can talk about that. But some of you may have heard on the news today that the mayor of Vancouver was meeting with the Minister of Finance to discuss his desire for a tax on vacant housing. And what you may not know is in 2008, when Gregor Robertson first ran, actually even before he got the nomination as the mayoral candidate, he actually was arguing at that time that there should be a tax on empty homes. So just for fun, I just want to read this to you. We need a tax on the ghost apartments, and it could be an important step in adding thousands of apartments for young families. So effective immediately, the cash-strapped municipality will double property taxes on the 10,000 or so ghost apartments generally inhabited by wealthy overseas homeowners who spend a fraction of their time in our city. Now, do you know which city we're talking about? Jerusalem. Did you know that? Anyway, I thought you'd find that of a bit of interest. Another thing happened today, which is worth paying attention to, a report was issued on the state of the real estate industry, not the developers, but the real estate agents. Because as you've been reading and hearing, there's a lot of very unscrupulous real estate agents out there. Well, why are they unscrupulous? Because they offer to sell your home or offer to help you buy a home, but more often they're trying to sell your home. They tell you they can get you, that it's worth $375,000, that you should ask $399,000. They bring you an offer of $378,000 and urge you to take it, and you don't know, you're relying on them, so you take it. And then you find out that 2 weeks later, they've now sold your house to somebody else who's paid $410,000. So they're going to get a commission from you, and then they're going to get a commission from another buyer, and this has been going on. And this is what they've been referring to as shadow flipping, and the real estate board is going to come down on people like that. The other thing is occasionally the agents will actually act for both the vendor and the purchaser. And the question is, how can they really be acting in everyone's best interest? So that's another thing that we can touch on tonight. So I am grateful to all of you for coming, and I hope none of you will leave without asking questions to address what's on your mind, no matter how silly you think the question is, or how personal it might be. I think that's what we're here for.
Thank you, Michael. Penny?
So, reflecting on, and I'm not sure how many of you were at the session in May, but reflecting that what's happened since May is I think there's some really positive signs that at least, as I think Tom made at the last session, is that we needed government sort of intervention into addressing this issue. So now, we said that there has been consultations, but I think more than that, there's also, other groups are sort of getting together that have been like the housing stakeholders to meet to really start formulating sort of ideas around housing that they could be for input into what the Liberal government is calling the National Housing Strategy, which a number of people have been calling for a number of years now. We need a national strategy that addresses housing, that would also address particular areas like Vancouver and Toronto. So that's occurring. I was at a three-hour consultation this afternoon where there's a whole group of people, a whole group of organizations that are trying to provide that kind of input already. So I'm fairly optimistic about that. The other thing that I think is really, that there's these, expediencies is that there is a provincial election, next year, and suddenly the province is saying that they are going to be, coming out with all of these new, ideas that they're going to be addressing in terms of housing. I'm waiting to see what they're actually going to say, because every time somebody else has tried to introduce these ideas, they've sort of shot them down and sort of went back to the sort of same old sort of rhetoric. It's the municipal problem, it's the federal problem, it's not our problem. I think that the biggest issue that I think both the federal and the provincial governments are facing right now in trying to address housing is that they're afraid that if they intervene in any way, this is going to have a major impact on the Canadian economy. And, it may very well be, because the kind of way that real estate has played so fundamental a role in places like Vancouver and Toronto, if they were trying to intervene, it could really, seriously impact what's going on. But this really points out to me that what the Canadian government needs, the federal government needs to do, the provincial government needs to do, is to develop a serious economic strategy that really diversifies the economy. We cannot be just dependent on global capital coming in and buying our real estate and then generating a whole real estate sort of industry from that. It has to become more diversified. And a place like Vancouver does not have that kind of large-scale diversification that is really needed for a healthy economy. So that's sort of some other issues. Some of the worrying signs things may not get better soon is something like Brexit, because I think as soon as something like that happens, people look for where is stability, and Canada in the world is probably one of the most stable countries. I mean, we have a social safety net, we have, there's things that need to be addressed, but we're still sort of a lot better off than a lot of other places. So we're still going to become very desirable. So the kind of pressure on on, you know, a place like Vancouver to be, you know, for more people wanting to move here. I think it is going to be growing. But I do think that in that the federal government and provincial government are now starting to address that. And, you know, given that, I mean, the municipalities are really, it's very difficult for them to be doing anything except for, you know, addressing zoning and density and things like that. But that, in a place like Vancouver, that, you know, when you're increasing the kind, you're making it more dense or increasing the supply, it isn't necessarily making things more affordable unless you actually put other sort of mechanisms in place.
Thank you. Okay, very good. Good thoughts.
Do any of you want us to repeat that?
Okay, we're going to get right. We're going to get right to the questions because we know that that's primarily why we're here. We want, as Michael said, we want to address your questions. We want to keep it interactive. There were a number of questions that were submitted through the website, and so we're going to start with a few of those, and then we're just going to open it up. But these are questions that have come from you when you registered. So, Michael. Where are home prices going, and what will Vancouver look like in 5 or 10 years if the pace, if the prices continue to rise at the pace that they have been?
So I'm not being rude here. I have the answer on the computer.
And I'm timing your answer.
So I found a column that I wanted to put on online. And now I had it all ready to go, and then I lost it. But what it is it's you're going to have as many people saying the prices are going to continue to go up because of Brexit, because people are going to be able to bring more money out of China, because we're a stable economy, etc., etc. And then you're going to have other people who are going to say this simply cannot continue the way it has been. And that if you look at the history of Vancouver, last year and the year before are not the only times we've seen dramatic increases in the price of housing. And I was actually surprised to see that there have been other years when we've had very dramatic increases in prices as well. And then they level off. And so I think there's two different points of view. My personal view, And I don't know, but I was here from about 1979 to 1980. House prices in Vancouver went up 45%. I don't know if that's true, but I read there was a period. And what happened is all of my friends were out there buying more than one house because they knew that they were going to go up. And then by 1982, the prices collapsed quite significantly. Now, it was a different time. We didn't have all the Chinese people coming. We didn't have a number of the things that we have today. But it wasn't that long ago. And I think I told you the last time I was here, I bought a little house at the corner of 33rd and Arbutus for half of what it had been listed for 14 months earlier when I first came to Vancouver. So, if I had to choose between the scenario that says this escalation of 20% per year is what we're going to see for the next 5 years, or to say that in fact one day we're going to wake up and everybody's going to say that the bubble has burst and the price of housing is simply starting to drop in Vancouver, it won't collapse. I don't think we're going to see 30 or 40% drops, but I do think it is going to peak at a certain point. The other thing is, as I think Penny and Tom have pointed out, some of the remedies that people have been asking for, taxing foreign investment in various ways, trying to put in place a tax on vacant homes, getting the federal government and the provincial government to provide some more money for different forms of affordable housing, taxing Airbnb and other things that are impacting the rental supply, collect plus building more, and we're going to talk about densification and so forth. All of those things I think will actually have some impact in terms of dampening prices a little bit. Whether they drop or whether they just stabilize, I don't know. What I do know is after Thursday, the stock market went crazy. Those of you who are invested or follow the market after Brexit, we saw a couple of hundred points drop one day and a couple of hundred points drop the next day, and then today it went up 150. Well, Brexit hasn't changed. If anything, the situation is more severe. But psychologically, some people said, Lloyds Bank is down 40%. It has to be a good time to buy. It's also psychologically driven, and that's why, unless you fully understand human behavior, I don't think we know for sure. So,
could
I just add to what you were talking about when there was total retraction of the housing market in the early 1980s was because. You're right. People woke up one day and the value of their house was half less of what it was. It was because interest rates were at 16% then, and that was one of the reasons that people just couldn't afford it.
And we are in a very low interest rate environment, and there's no sign of that changing in the near future. So,
you know, if you're a homeowner and you want to hedge your house's value, I really think you should buy oil stocks. Buy oil stocks. Here's why. You know, we're an export housing market, right? See, there's two demand curves. I think the China story and eventually all the other countries in the world, we really are a tax haven, no questions asked. It's a fantastic place for stability, hide your money, all that stuff. That's going to keep going in the long run. So we're exporting real estate. If the foreign market died, which I don't think it will, there's no way I've been saying prices don't fall 25 to 50%. If tomorrow you said, you know what, that's it, we're a domestic market, you know, it would be a horror show. We'd be at like Seattle minus. So we're an export market, which means the weakness of the loonie is great for prices. And the loonie's pretty much an oil dollar. So as oil prices go up, the loonie gets stronger. I think that's bad for Vancouver housing. Moreover, like you mentioned, the only world in which I think oil prices recover is a higher interest rate, higher inflation, happier world, and then the flight to quality, the need to really worry and put something everything safe in both mortgages, which makes the money cheaper, and Vancouver per se. So that's my little conjecture. It's a pretty much, Vancouver and oil at this point, I would see, is very negatively correlated. Oh, and then there's my yuppie MBA students. You know, they used to all leave for Alberta. So, you know, all the millennials with brains were getting out of here. Well, that shut down. So they're back in town, and that's putting up with pressure. So that's a pet theory of mine.
Thank you. Let's open the floor, because I know you are all eager. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, I think to give you a thoughtful answer, we need to narrow this question down. Because to my mind, there's a difference between you asking me, would you buy an older home or in New Westminster, or would you buy into Concert Properties, the new development at the east end of Falls Creek at $1,100 per square foot, are two entirely different questions.
Let's say a simple house in
east side of Vancouver?
Yeah.
Simple house in east side of Vancouver.
Detached?
Detached.
So $2 million.
Well, I mean, take this idea, if you had the money, you could do whatever you wanted with it, would you be a buyer, or would you say, no, there's probably a better buying opportunity?
All right. So, here we're now getting into the important stuff. Are you buying for yourself because you need a roof over your head? Or are you saying, I've got $1 million to invest, what? And I'd like to invest it in real estate, what should I do with it? To my mind, there's two different questions.
At least you have your principal residence, you've got a certain amount of money, whatever the down payment would be on a cash flow neutral property in Vancouver, would you be a buyer today, or?
I don't think I would buy a detached house on the east side of Vancouver right now expecting significant appreciation. I think you'd be better off investing that money in some other markets that haven't seen as rapid an appreciation as we've seen. And if you say, well, where? Well, I think last time I talked about places like Maple Ridge, or maybe parts of New Westminster, or Squamish, or some Bowen Island, the Sunshine Coast. I think you might, but then you've got to look at, are you going to get income coming out of that property, or are you buying land, and so forth.
This anchor comes when you of driving, you know, the great drive to qualify, like, or, you know, New West, I think, is a good market, but further than that, are you driving to qualify?
But it's, you're going to buy, but again, if you're saying to me, where should I buy for my home, then we could talk about your values, and do you want to commute, and all of that. But if it's simply trying to invest, there are other people who will keep driving until they find a place that they can afford, and they don't have the same reservations about commuting an hour every day or an hour and 15 minutes every day that some of the people in this room would have, because you want to be closer to schools or the community or other reasons.
So I would look at it, and I look at it in terms of patterns of what's happened in the Vancouver market over a number of years, and it's, and it's all